All right, folks, you may be wondering what a 56-year-old mutt and a 2-month-old chicken have in common. And as I will tell you later on in the episode, oddly enough, not a lot except for this right here. So what we're gonna be talking about today is actually lifts. The dog and the chicken have a play in this somewhere down the road, but I'm gonna be talking about that a little bit later on. So right now, get ready, because we're gonna be talking about lift stuff, tips, tricks, and whatnot. I'm gonna take a couple seconds to talk to you about National Parts Depot. We get most of our parts for the show here from the guys at National Parts Depot, simply put, because they have the stuff in stock. Now, our lift obviously didn't come from the guys at National Parts Depot, but pretty much everything else that we use around here does. Those guys have the stuff in stock. They have 4 convenient locations nationwide. They have one in Ocala, Florida, one in Charlotte, North Carolina, one in Detroit, Michigan, and another in Los Angeles, California. These parts are available to you 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, either from the website or the quick phone call to their 1-800 number, where you can get a person to talk to almost every day of the year, with the exception of a few holidays. Parts in stock, toll-free number, website that you can get to anywhere in the world. What's not to like? Why don't you give them a call and check them out? All right. First things first, what I will tell you to do is to measure twice and cut once. The old carpenter's adage really applies here with lifts. And what I mean by that is you need to actually go out and measure your garage and make sure that whatever you're looking at will fit. I went through a bunch of lift companies before I came to Wildfire. They had a lift that fit the area that I want to put it in, which is the maximum width of the lift matches with the maximum width of that area. For over here in this side of the garage, it wouldn't have mattered, but since I want to be able to store cars on the backside of where we actually do our filming work, I figured we wanted to get a lift that would fit in that area more compactly. The Wildfire lift that we bought does that. So from there, I want to move on to a couple of other things. Basically, what I want to do is I want to go over some of the things that I've been asked by the viewers out there with regards to the lift that we've got here in the shop. I wanted to go over our garage minimums, things that you can and can't do inside of your typical garage here in the US. Now, one thing I will say is this, is you can get away with a lift in a garage with about an 8'4" or a little bit more ceiling height, but by that token, you will not be able to put another car underneath the lift. We put ours up to where it is right now, which is just under where the rails for the garage door are. You're gonna end up having about 44" underneath the runways, and unless you own a GT40 that is at race height, you're not gonna get a whole lot underneath this lift where it is set up right now. But the nice thing about it is you will be able to work underneath the car on something like my Mychanic stool that I'm sitting on right now. If you have a nice stool that you can work on, I can tell you right now that you'll have plenty of room if you're running at a stock ride height on your vehicle. Now, our Mach 1 that's on the lift right now is sitting at a stock ride height. We have about 7" between the runway and the bottom of the floor pans. It gives us a total of about 55". And I guess I'm about average height. I'm 6 foot tall. So at 6 foot tall, I'm probably what? I don't know. Let's just say it's enough. I've got enough lift that I can go and still not touch my head on the bottom of the mufflers of the car. So what you're looking for in a case like that is you're looking for a way to work on the car on a lift, and this is a good way to get it done. It's not gonna be for storage. You're not gonna get any storage out of it just simply because you don't have any room inside of the garage. If you have right at an 8-foot ceiling, it becomes a way to work, not a way to put the car in the air to put another vehicle underneath it. Now, if you have a lift with casters on it, you will want to have about 18, minimum of 18 to 20 feet, depending on the cross distance on your pads if you have the caster kit. So you're gonna be looking at needing at least 18 feet to be able to spin the thing around inside the garage. And you may be sitting there going, well, why do I wanna spin my lift around? Trust me, I didn't think we would be moving this lift as much as we have been, but we have been moving this lift an awful lot inside of the garage confines just to do things on the show here. Now, you don't run a show probably using a lift, but what you may want to do is to move the lift from one position in a two-car garage to the other so that you can do something else within the garage. You may even want to do what we've done here, which is put the car horizontally so it's easier to get to your tools at the front of the garage if you're working in a relatively small garage. Now, another thing you're going to be dealing with possibly is hang down from the ceiling. Your ceiling height may be 9 foot, but if you've got a garage door and garage door opener that have the tracks in it, you have lights overhead, you may do like we have and have a reel for your power outlet. All those things are gonna have to be taken into account for, because you don't wanna wreck the roof of your car when you put it on the lift and put it up in the air. And there's some tips and tricks on the garage door arms and stuff that I'm gonna talk about in the tips and tricks section coming up here in a second. But just look at all that whenever you're doing this, because some of this stuff is going to be a pretty heavy additional expense if you have to go in and make changes in order to put the lift into the garage bay. So now what I'm going to talk about is what our setup is here at the shop, because that was probably the most asked question we had of any on the lift video we did just a while back. All right, so we originally thought that our garage height in here from floor to ceiling was 13 feet. It is not. It is in fact 10 feet 7 inches tall. I owe that to my art upbringing and not being a super mathematician, because I added it up wrong when I measured it the first time. So fire me. Another thing, our garage is 23 feet deep, which is really good for being able to spin this particular lift around. It's about 118 inches on a cross measure, so we're good to go with that. We also have very flat floors in here. That's the last thing I'll say about our garage, is our floors, if they aren't flat, you could run into a real issue with the lift, with it being a little tilty, and you want to talk to your lift manufacturer about that, what the grade that you can have on your garage floor that is safe with their lift. I'm gonna guarantee that most of them are gonna say that the floor needs to be perfectly flat, that you don't want any kind of grade on the floor, because a grade with a four-post lift or even a two-post lift is counterproductive to having your car stay on the lift. You wanna have a nice flat floor when you're doing this. All right, so I'm gonna talk about tips and tricks now. Some things that I've come across that kind of make life a little bit easier if you're working with a lift. If you're doing a four-post lift like we are using here, one of the things I've thought about doing and I'm going doing here is I'm going to mark my lift on the post where the normal run position is for us when we're working under the vehicle. Right now we're at 44 inches from the floor, so I marked the lift with a little bit of masking tape right now just to make sure that we know where we are at for our normal position for being able to work underneath the car. It just makes things a little bit easier, and then you can also mark the lift higher up for your maximum position when you're going for your ceiling height, so that you know where it is. You don't have to keep worrying about what position to go to. It's already marked on the post that you can see from your lift position when you're using the button to put the lift up in the air. Now, if you have casters that came with your lift, clean your floor. Make sure you have a nice, smooth, flat floor to run this thing around on if you have a car on the lift. You can probably roll it around okay if the floor is a rough floor, but smooth floors are always better if there's a car on the lift. So do that, because I'm gonna tell you right now, something as small as this butt connector right here can actually stop a lift in its tracks. Now, another cool little thing that we're gonna be doing with our lift is we're going to be using LED lights along the runways on the underside of the lift. We haven't gotten those in yet, but we're going to take the LEDs, we're going to use piano hinge and actually place the LEDs on the piano hinge so that we can angle them to where we need them to be underneath the vehicle. It'll just make it a lot easier to get any work done. And for us, from a shooting aspect for video, it's going to make things really nice, because we don't have to worry about trying to place lights in order to make things work. We can cover up what we don't need and use what we do. The ones that we are getting that I'm showing you right now, there's a URL for the Amazon line on that. I'm telling you, it's a good thing to do, because you can have red lights, blue lights. If you want to have a party in your garage, you could probably have them flash and do all kind of crazy crap that I'm not ever going to do with them. But I can adjust the Kelvin for my lights to be a warm light, a blue light, whatever I need in order to get what I need to get done underneath the vehicle for our shooting purposes. But from your point of view, when you're working on the car, it'll get you a lot of nice angled lighting so that you can take a look at what you're doing. Remember too, a nice safety tip for this, you will need a little bit of room above where your stop is on your lift to be able to pick the car up, get it off the safety catches, and then drop the car down. So you're gonna need probably 5 inches or so, so that when you're picking the vehicle up, you can open up those safety catches to drop the vehicle back down to the ground. So if you're putting it up in the air, don't go far enough that you are above where the safety catches come out, because I usually find that they catch in at a lower level than they come out. So you'll wanna make sure that you've got a little bit of wiggle room of about 6 to 8 inches above the vehicle, so that whenever you're lifting it, you're not running into the roof and damaging both your ceiling and the roof of your car. Now, another thing we were talking about, the arms for the garage doors. Let me do that again. Now, another thing, we were talking about the garage door arms, and what I'm gonna say about that is you can get a high lift garage door assembly that actually moves the doors to where they're very close to the ceiling when they go into their roll-up position. The only thing I will say about that, though, is if you have to do that, you're gonna be buying a very expensive side mount lift motor for them. They're usually running around $300 to $500 or more dollars for a side lift, and especially if you're running one like we are with an insulated door on it, it's very heavy. So you're gonna have to keep in mind that that is going to be an issue possibly for expense if you wanna move it so that you can just have the car in there with the lift up in the air, because you will not a lot of times be able to put the lift very far up in the air if the garage door is open. So a high lift is probably a good idea, but it's just going to add an expense to your lift cost because you're going to have to get the high lift stuff to make it work. All right, finally, we're down to the mutt and the chicken. The mutt is one that my mom and dad gave to me when I was a kid, and I'm talking about a little kid. This thing is 56 years old, and oddly enough, the squeaker still works. The chicken is new, and what I bought the chicken for was I wanted to use the chicken as my emergency you need to stop now squeaker toy. There is one problem with the chicken. The chicken, you squeeze it, and then it makes the noise. At least with the mutt, you squeeze it and it immediately makes noise. My only thing is I really like my mutt. I've had my mutt for a long time, like 56 years. It's born the same time I'm born, so I'm a little reluctant to just throw it up on top of the car and use it. The other problem I have is that I haven't found another squeaky toy that is exactly like this to use as an emergency stop warning. Because what I think you could do is just put the mutt sitting on top of the car, and if he gets close to the roof, he'll at least make some noise. But I found out all this research for something that just didn't work. I found out that the mutt, you can't, if you depress him slowly like the lift goes up, he's real quiet. He doesn't talk much. And if the lift went up quick, he'd be making a lot of racket, but he's not making a lot of racket. So this may not work. I have yet to find something that I'm satisfied with for an emergency noise to let you know that you're really close to the roof when you're putting the car up in the air. So I'm not sure what the chicken or the mutt are going to do to like fix that, because the mutt is kind of quiet and the chicken is only noisy whenever it's exhaling. I don't know. I'm not throwing the mutt. I like the mutt. He's mine. Well, looky there. We actually found a use for the mutt. Hey, what do you know? Actually, I figured out what to do with him or the chicken. Either one. You put them on top of the roof of the car, or you stick them up somehow from the roof of the car. And as the car goes up on the lift, you can kind of get a better idea how far you are from the top of your car to the ceiling. So there you go. It's a good way to actually keep track of how high the car is within the confines of your shop. Now, do us a favor and go out and like and subscribe to us. If you hit the notification bell, you'll be notified anytime we have a video coming up. Also, go out and check out our Patreon account. The link for that is in the description below. You guys have a great week. We'll see you later on Autorestomod.